BC TV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Hi, good evening to Poets Pause. Welcome to Poets Pause. My name is Marilyn Klimcho. I'll be your host for this evening. And I'm going to start the program off, first of all, by inviting you to attend First Thursdays at the Goggle Works. Burke's Bards has poets Michael Czarnecki and Hiram LaRue scheduled for December, and we would really love to have a big audience. These are great guys. Hiram is from the Maryland area near Washington, D.C., and Michael Czarnecki hails from upstate New York. And that's at 6 o'clock in the Goggle Works. Going to be a great reading, and there'll be an open mic to follow. The other event that you need to be aware of is Second Tuesday, which takes place in Aladdin's. In West Reading on Penn Street, and that's a gathering of people who share poetry and read to each other and enjoy a meal together. And we just had Second Tuesday last evening, and it was really quite nice. So I'd encourage you to come to the December event as well. So my poet this evening is Dianne Seaman. Her poetry has an emphasis in spirituality and nature. She's a graduate of Albright.
Yes.
Which is wonderful. And I'm going to start this introduction by reading a poem that she particularly likes by John O'Donohue. And it's called Blessing. And I'm just going to read the first lines of it. On the day when the weight deadens on your shoulders and you stumble, may the clay dance to balance you. And when your eyes freeze behind the gray window and the ghost of loss gets into you, may a flock of colors, indigo, red, green, and azure blue, come to waken you in a meadow of delight. So that was the opening of his poem. I'll leave it to you to go find the rest of it and see it. So, Dianne, you are focused primarily on spirituality, primarily on nature. Would you share some of your poetry with us?
I would be glad to, Marilyn.
Thank you.
The first one is called Edible Sacredness, and it is, in a way, a Thanksgiving poem without mentioning a turkey, however. And I was very honored that several people who bought my book told me they were going to read this at their Thanksgiving dinner.
Okay.
So the title is Edible Sacredness. If you've ever gazed deeply at a small, dried tomato seed, you'd wonder where the potential of its sacramental red flesh lay hidden. If you've ever stood under a peach tree with sticky hands, the juice of its offspring firing your taste buds, you'd feel the awe of dry, brown bark transforming its tips into round, moist sweetness. If you've ever dug a potato, its roots swelling into culinary versatility, you'd know that every bite of food we put into our mouths is a miracle. If you've ever stopped to remember the mystery behind the earth's nurturance, you would have said grace.
I love that. Now, I have to tell the audience, I have not heard this poem before.
No, I don't believe you have.
And I would love to read that one at my Thanksgiving.
Well, I'd be honored, Marilyn.
It never, you know, we do a little celebration, and I usually hand out slips of paper and say, here, write something about you're thankful for, right, and then we'll guess who did it. But that poem.
I'll email you a copy.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I would love it. Would you share some more?
Yes, and since it's autumn, I have a few with the autumn, autumnal theme. This one is called Autumn's Lament. Deep down, warm garden beds turn into cool dankness. Seasonal whirls scoop out from the inside before the outward signals of change appear, mournful of a season passing. The seasons in a life, even hot, dry ones that never caused a moment's pleasure, are grieved when they pass. For change resembles death. Something is gone, even if what is better off for the passing. It's the sense of the irretrievable that pricks our sensibilities. Something is plucked from us forever. Good riddance, we should say. But how to let go and progress into unfamiliar lands of unpredictable winds? We know not from this point into what forms these winds will whittle us. Yet, we must stand bravely upon the craggy summit, letting its force banter us about, allowing all surfaces to be exposed, yielding to the alteration and change. No hiding. The crescent moon sinks into the hills as the wind dies down. And soon we will descend to face another term in yet another form, after having entered the storm's peaceful eye for an interim of stillness.
I love that because I got the impression of Western landscapes where you can see every strata.
Crag.
Every strata exposed to
That's
the wind.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have made that connection, but everybody reads subjective impressions into poetry, which is part of its beauty.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Some more autumn ones. I like this one. I think this one is very relevant for our times in this country since the racism issue has reared its head again. Mm-hmm. And I wrote this. It's a short one. I wrote it very spontaneously while I was walking across fields at my farm.
Okay.
And they had cut down the corn, and there was just, you know, the stubble. I'm sure
right.
Berks Countyans have all seen that.
Oh, we've all seen that.
Okay. So this one's called Harvest Time. And this came really, like, it just dropped in, like it was downloaded from somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Some come like that. That's the nice, those are the easy ones, right,
Marilyn?
Yeah,
simple.
Those are the easy ones, okay. Cornstalk stubble protrudes like a day-old beard on the brown skin of the earth. Brown skins echo the soil, lighter skins the wheat. An extension of nature is what we are, planted here by the great gardener. How did such hatred grow out of that? We should be harvesting love.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Very nice.
And then I have a few haikus, which are just little short ones. You know those red bushes that turn bright red?
I love those.
I love those, and I don't know what they are.
I don't know either.
Okay, but I wrote this as I was walking one morning. Small red leaves, autumn's rose petals, stain the ground, earthbound sun. And then another haiku. Digging potatoes, Easter egg hunt underground.
Have you ever grown yams?
No, I've grown potatoes, but not yams.
Well, they are a wonder to behold because when you find them, there are so many. It's like finding a pot of gold.
Oh, that's really wonderful. Is. Or a whole Easter basket of
Oh,
Easter
my
eggs.
God. Oh, my God. I love yams.
I have to try that sometime.
Yeah.
Okay, the next autumnal one is called Ancient Rhythms. I walked a lot across fields, so I have that theme in this one. I walk across the fields, my church, this wintry Sunday morning. Cobb's mist in the fall harvest lay on the brown earth, the altar of Demeter where I now worship. I gather field corn for the horses and wonder what mystery under my feet is preparing for spring's emergence, as yet unseen, but faintly sensed in the faith of an ever-renewing cycle, in which life forms, dissolves, then forms again, which is as it should be. We tamper unwisely with the ancient wisdom.
So I would imagine that you have a lot of feelings about the climate change issues that are plaguing us.
It's very disturbing, yeah.
Yeah.
It really is.
Yeah. And I understand that you know, due to family situation and care for an elderly relative, you really haven't had a chance to write in the recent years.
Not as much as I had in the past.
Yeah.
But as we've spoken, I'm inspired
you're
by
feeling.
Yeah,
you're
I'm
feeling that
like
churning,
pumped up, which is why poets need to hang out together.
Yes. Yes.
A plug for you know the Tuesday night monthly gathering and
yes.
for Berks Bards.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. So since there's a snow in the forecast for tomorrow.
Oh God.
Heaven forbid. It's only November, people. I thought I'd read one called First Snow, just in honor of our forecast.
Yes.
In honor of our forecast.
Yes.
So we're moving from autumn to first snow. Dark equine silhouettes float across the snow as they weave through a dark stand of trees. Hushed hoofbeats make no sound, creating the illusion of ghost horses who toss their heads gleefully in a night of wet whiteness. This ethereal world silences even the giants among us.
You know, I think nature provides just such a bounty of imagery to draw from. I think it's the starting point for most poets.
Is it really nature?
I would think. Mm-hmm. I would think.
I never thought about it, Marilyn.
You know, there are some people who you know like would take a political stance or a social agenda, but.
Great segue into my next one, by the way, Marilyn.
Go ahead. Go ahead. I didn't know.
The next one I know. This is intriguing. You just gave me a segue. Because I'm now moving, although field is in the first line, so I can't get away from my field imagery.
Can't.
But this is called The Despair of the Strip Shopping Mall. And I wrote this ages ago when on Route 183, I watched them, you know, just put up another strip shopping mall and development in what was once farmland.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Another field yields to concrete. Can't you feel it? Despair. Surfacing first from the macadam emptiness, then trailing through hollow walls of tree transient particle board. No noble architecture here to celebrate centuries down the path. But an instant, barren greed monster to be fed its insatiable appetite of meaningless stuff. No heart soars walking along these walls. Souls empty out along with wallets. Things will not feed our hollow hunger, no matter how hard we pretend such. Footsteps across the treeless landscape return us to our cars, our lives. Lives better filled with meaning than things, but where to shop for that?
Where to shop for that? You know, I was just listening to to NPR report as I was coming over, and they were describing how hurricanes are now drenching us with more rain.
Mm-hmm.
And they said part of that is the result of actually building buildings that stick up so high that the wind is forced to rise and put the moist air in.
I didn't know those
in
two
contact,
were connected.
Hmm. In contact with a colder layer of air, and therefore more rain is wrung out of the atmosphere.
Well, I hadn't heard that element.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's, you know, like I said, I listened to it on NPR tonight, so it's very new approach.
Okay, along the environmental theme again, a voice for the punk crowd. You give me more unnecessary plastic baubles in place of flowering trees, more parking lots in place of expansive fields. Then you wonder why I look and dress like death.
Ooh.
That one was short to the point.
That was short to the point.
Okay. Keeping with this theme, I'll do one more.
Okay.
This is a little whimsical. And this is all written in 98 because I'm talking about the Unabomber, but
okay.
I think many of our audience would probably remember the Unabomber.
Yes, I would think.
Okay. So the title is, To the Unabomber. Yes, technology can be a monster, but wouldn't poems be better than bombs? And technology's even gotten a lot worse since 98, so this is even more relevant than ever.
Yes.
The world will try and chop you up in its little fragments, all flying at different speeds to different places, making it hard for the whole you to go anywhere. It's a war, a battle, at least, against television, telemarketers, telephones, tell them to leave you alone. You've got inner space as your destination, and to get there, you need quiet and calm. Outer space is already too cluttered with more and more telecommunication satellites. It's a battle not to drown when octopus teletentacles grab you under. Hack them off one by one while chanting Om and flow into your wholeness, holiness.
So you were telling me that part of your process is to go out and take a walk.
Yes, I've always been a walker, and I walk every morning, mm-hmm. All weather, inspired a whole lot by my dogs who don't let me pass it by when it's kind of nasty.
What kind of dogs do you have?
Weimaraner and a little Lhasa mix.
Okay.
Both rescues.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I always feel better after I go, even if the weather's lousy.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, walking just makes you feel better.
Walking does make you feel better.
Yeah. And it
clears the mind, too.
Because we were comparing our experience, and I was trying to develop a poem while walking on the treadmill, and I had absolutely success. Because there were three television screens where I was working
and
out.
And I kind of challenge you that you even thought you could have done that.
You know, I threw this mind over matter. I fail. I tried.
That was a lesson about technology not inspiring you.
Yes,
you know, and nature was more inspirational.
Yeah.
So personally, I think silence and quiet is necessary for me to create. I think it's necessary for a lot of us to have balance in our lives, and I think we get far too little in this day and age.
Right.
So the next one is about silence, and it's called The Fertile Void. Luxurious silence here. One can listen to the whisperings across galaxies. So quiet, one can hear throughout eternity and perceive one's name etched in timeless sands. The name that never washes away in the ebb and flow of tides. Sit long enough in silence and it is given to you like a bell ringing in the cathedral of your heart.
That's very nice.
Thank you.
That's very nice.
So,
did you have more that you
wanted
to
do.
Share?
Yes, I do. I'm just... the next one is also very much about silence. This is called The Still Point. Sabbath is a still point, not limited to Sunday, but any day, any time we seek the silence. The silence that allows the voluptuousness of our souls to emerge. But people, frightened by this vaster unknown self, shrink wrap themselves back into the plastic phoniness of every day, the noisy clutter conspiring to shelter us from our glory.
You know, as a person who's recently retired, I actively walk down supermarket aisles and department store aisles and say, I don't need that. I don't need this. I don't need that.
Mm-hmm.
I go on non-buying trips.
So to make conscious choices.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. To get that clutter out of
mm-hmm.
the way.
Mm-hmm. So the next one is one of my oldest ones, and this I wrote already in 86, so this is over 30 years old. And I was living in Atlanta at the time, and I remember this one just kind of flowed through me from who knows where they drop in. You know, mm-hmm. when the muse calls, it's lovely, and grab a pen and paper and get it down. I've made too many mistakes thinking I'd remember it later. I'm sure all done that.
Don't do that.
We've all done that.
Yeah, you write it down
You
now.
Get it in the moment. So this is called White Winds, and I have no idea where this came from, except it came through me. That's how it felt. I live in the realm where the wind sweeps through rocks, gathering spirals of milky white clouds to penetrate beneath the crevices. It is a soft region with no hard lines of definition, creating weak absolutes out of the need to be sure. My world enters yours, and we rock to a new rhythm. Beyond the time of the past, our fathers knew. It is essential woman in all of us that must rock this new world, cradling the earth to the larger bosom of our own female deity. We wander not, walk not, unguided by infinite fingers, painting the new backdrop. The rings drop off and marry with our own, each of us a bride, joining in partnership with the as yet unknown, the fertile void out of which will spring a new garden. Extensions of our mind glide like an amoeba to far reaches, beyond our previously wildest imagination, yet within the pulsing fantasies we are coming to call commonplace.
I almost want to sit down and read that over
this
again.
This one is long, one of my longer ones, mm-hmm. and it has imagery that I've never used before or since. It really feels like
someone else wrote it.
It downloaded through me.
Yeah.
And I think it's almost more relevant now because there's so much about, much more talk now than in 86 about needing to integrate and balance the masculine and feminine principles mm-hmm. in life for our own mental health and for the health of the planet and the environment. Right.
And I noticed that you do have a female deity mm-hmm. in your work.
Oh, interesting
observation. I mean, you know, that you concentrate on that. I'm going to take a few moments right now.
I just have one more I want to make sure I get to.
And we will do
I know
that.
We're running out of time, so
yeah,
I thought I'd give you a heads up.
We will do that right after. I usually give out a writing prompt, and next month's writing prompt is on the theme of giving in appreciation of December and the holidays. So you're to write up to 17 lines of poetry on that theme. On the screen, you'll see where to send it to. And if I get it by December 11th, and I think it's great, we will read it live on BCTV on December 12th for Poets Pause. So please feel encouraged to write and send me a poem. And
okay, well, this one is very much a Southeast Berks Lancaster County poem.
Okay.
Interestingly enough, I wrote this after I was returning from Kutztown, where I went to poetry readings at UCC Church ages ago with Harry Sirio and a bunch of people would get together once a month on a Sunday, and I drove back roads from Kutztown.
Okay.
And
that's a beautiful countryside.
It's a beautiful drive, one of my favorite drives, yeah. And there was a horse and buggy.
Yeah, oh yes.
And this poem just came to me. So it's called Time on a Back Road in Pennsylvania. In the blink of an eye, different decades, ages, suddenly coexist on a simultaneously overlapping screen. Pick your era to live in at any given moment in so-called time. The clip-clopping of horses' hooves rhythmically pound the macadam, pulling buggies along former Indian pathways, and blend with the whirring of horse-powered engines biding their time for a passing lane. Time is not what we think.
I graduated from Kutztown.
Okay.
And I would occasionally see the buggy going through campus.
Oh, how interesting.
You know?
I didn't realize they went through town.
Oh,
I've never seen buggies in Kutztown, borough proper.
Well, they didn't go on the main street. They cut in behind the college and went through. And I don't know quite why.
Probably because there's less traffic, I would think.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah.
But I love the concept of time, too, you know. And
that it collapsed.
Collapsed, you know. And I work as a past life therapist, I think, you know.
Yes.
And when you work in past life therapy, you're literally going into people's psyches and time collapses, meaning there's no difference in their unconscious between 1710 and 2018. And it's almost like simultaneous time or multidimensional time, and it's absolutely fascinating to work with.
I wrote a poem about finding my caveman ancestors.
Well, that sounds like an intriguing one, Marilyn.
While entering a snowbound Toyota, you know.
Well, there you go.
And the, you know,
you're
in this cave of a car that's getting ready for work, but the snow is covering everything.
Well, that was an interesting theme.
I loved it.
Yeah, so you like that time theme.
Yes, if you have a short one.
Yeah, let me, I do have a real short one, if I can find it. I thought I had these marked easily. Well, I'll just grab one.
Okay, we have about 1 minute left.
Here's one for precursor of winter. Snow-covered hills with valleys, not in the shadow of death, but rather filled with white hope. First we descend, then climb. Both are essential to reach the peaks where snow-covered crocus push through the frozen white.
That is lovely.
Thank you.
Thank you for giving us that.
You're image. Very welcome. And since winter's right around the corner, especially with tomorrow's forecast, we had to move on from the autumn ones into the winter one.
Yes.
You know, it's coming, folks.
Because it is. It is. Thank you so much, Dianne.
It's been a pleasure, Marilyn.
And I really appreciate your spending time with my audience.
It's been a pleasure, as I said.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.